Hello and welcome to our service online today. We're so glad you could join us today for a time of worship, of prayer and a study as we look at Joseph's life and how God meant it all for good. Today in spring of 2020, we are in the midst of a global pandemic, and this has meant a great amount of suffering, of tragedy and of loss for people. For hardship and loneliness for others, and for stress and irregular behavior for families. Jesus himself warned his disciples that the world would cause them trouble, but he also said that they should take heart because he was bigger and he had overcome the world. And so we meet together in the knowledge that our Savior is King over all these things. He is sovereign, he has a plan, and he is bigger than anything the world has. So today, as his church, we can meet together and rejoice that he is King.
Hello everyone. Well, we have had an amazing start to our new church prayer time, where 18 people joined in via Zoom. Isn't it brilliant that we can come together to share in these difficult days? I just want to remind everyone that this prayer time is on every Tuesday night for the next 6 weeks. It starts at 8 o'clock and it lasts about 40 minutes. If you would like to join in, please contact me, Carolyn, or Liz McLenican, or Sandra. I also want to tell you about something else that's coming up very soon, and I know you will want to be a part of it. It's a quiz night, and we will give you more details on this in the coming weeks. Won't that be a bit of fun for everyone on a lockdown evening? See you on Tuesday night again. Bye!
Father God, we come before you this morning, thanking you for the privilege of praying for others. We lift up those in our church, our village, and our neighbourhoods. Jesus, during your ministry on earth, you showed your power and caring by healing people. Be present now to people who need your loving touch because of illness, including COVID-19. God, we pray for healthcare workers renew their energy and sustain them on long shifts. Multiply their supplies so they have protective items needed to stay safe on the job. Inspire and invigorate the research scientists developing tests to diagnose the virus, create vaccines and identify protocols to eliminate the disease's spread. Father, be with people making decisions that affect the lives and futures of our families, communities, countries and the wider world. Give them your mind and surround them with godly counsellors who will exercise integrity and work for justice, morality and freedom. Help them to esteem you. Holy Spirit, as families just to being at home, we ask that you guide people in their new realities. Give spouses grace for each other. Prompt worn-out parents to speak words of kindness and encouragement to their children. We pray that those who are lonely will experience the comfort of your presence. Jesus, as people feel financial strain during the uncertainty, bring them comfort and peace, reminding them that you are there for them. Provide for them in their times of need. Lord, we are so grateful for all the people who continue to work each day so that people are able to eat. We ask that you bless and protect them. Keep their bodies healthy and their vehicles running smoothly. Please protect them all from contracting the COVID-19. Lord, we pray your protection for those living in especially challenging circumstances as this virus spreads throughout the world, including countries where there's limited healthcare provision and where people are living in the cramped conditions of a refugee camp. Lord, we pray for guidance in how you want us to help in any of these circumstances. So many needs, Jesus, but you are adequate for every need. Your name is powerful and your power is great. So it's in your name that we pray and believe. Amen.
God is good and God is sovereign. This is the unchanging truth about God of the Christian faith that we are discovering evidence for in the Bible's account of Joseph's life. In Genesis 37, the scene is set for us when God chooses Joseph for a great service and also for great faith, but at 17 years old, Joseph is only a diamond in the rough, and we saw that he was going to need a lot of spiritual polishing. His jealous brothers, they conspire to kill him, but they sell him instead into slavery in Egypt, where he ends up far from home in that distant land. And maybe much like us, whenever we are in the eye of a storm, I wonder, did Joseph ask, how is God good? How is God sovereign in this? And then over in Genesis 39, we find Joseph. He's in lockdown. He is a slave in Potiphar's household. And our question of where is God's goodness and sovereignty and all that's happening to Joseph, it is answered. We are given evidence there that the Lord is with Joseph. He helps Joseph to adjust. He promotes him up through the ranks of Potiphar's house. He prepares him for a brand new career yet to come as the Prime Minister of Egypt. And then at the end of the story, we discover that with the Lord's help, Joseph is able to overcome a great test of moral temptation whenever Potiphar's wife presses him for an adulterous relationship. And she is spurned when Joseph says no, and so she turns and she accuses Joseph of rape. He is summarily imprisoned. And then perhaps like us, whenever a next discouragement comes along to knock us down, I wonder, as we leave Joseph at the end of chapter 39, is he again asking, how is God good And how is God sovereign in this? And so today we step into Genesis 40, and we need a message from God for discouraging times when things change suddenly around us, when we find ourselves in a waiting time or in a hurting time for life. We need to know that we are able to hold on to the Lord Jesus, who is good and who is sovereign. And so we're going to listen now as that next passage is read for us from Genesis 40, from verse 1 through to verse 15.
Our reading is taken from Genesis 40, verses 1 to 15. Joseph interprets two dreams. Sometime later, Pharaoh's chief cupbearer and chief baker offended their royal master. Pharaoh became angry with these two officials, and he put them in the prison where Joseph was, in the palace of the captain of the guard. They remained in prison for quite some time, and the captain of the guard assigned them to Joseph, who looked after them. While they were in prison, Pharaoh's cupbearer and baker each had a dream one night, and each dream had its own meaning. When Joseph saw them the next morning, he noticed that they both looked upset. "Why do you look so worried today?" he asked them. And they replied, "We both had dreams last night, but no one can tell us what they mean." "Interpreting dreams is God's business," Joseph replied. "Go ahead and tell me your dreams." So the chief cupbearer told Joseph his dream first. "In my dream," he said, "I saw a grapevine in front of me. The vine had three branches that began to bud and blossom, and soon it produced clusters of ripe grapes. I was holding Pharaoh's cup in my hand, so I took a cluster of grapes and squeezed the juice into the cup. Then I placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand." "This is what the dream means," Joseph said. "The three branches represent 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift you up and restore you to your position as his chief cupbearer. And please remember me and do me a favor when things go well for you. Mention me to Pharaoh so he might let me out of this place. For I was kidnapped from my homeland, the land of the Hebrews, and now I'm here in prison, but I did nothing to deserve it."
Can I invite you to allow me to lead us in a short prayer? Father God, give us the words, we pray, through your Holy Spirit, so that we are able to bring our lives to you today as God the Father, and we do through Jesus Christ. And Father God, we acknowledge that life often takes us to the end of ourselves, and it does so in so many different ways. Our prayer is that through what you teach us today, we will know that when our energy and words and understanding and resources are just spent, we will be able to trust in Jesus Christ as a Saviour and Lord and friend who is ever present, who protects and provides. Father God, we ask this in Jesus' name. We have been riding a real roller coaster with Joseph, his life and his faith and all of the emotions that we've walked through him with in Genesis 37 and Genesis 39. And those two chapters have spanned several years of his young life. But as we followed that roller coaster, what we have also done, we have seen the evidence there that in the pain and in the suffering, the living God of the Bible, he is present and he is good and he is working out his sovereign plans to mould this flawed teenager into a future prime minister of Egypt. God's extraordinary plans for Joseph to save his family and the nation of Israel and also the people of Egypt and the surrounding nations from a catastrophic famine, they're going to take extraordinary preparations. In Genesis 40, the God who loves Joseph and also who loves us, he teaches that we are at our strongest and bravest and boldest whenever we are in that place of total surrender to God. Now, as you listen, that might sound humanly absolutely crazy that total submission is able to bring victory and rejoicing. But spiritually, the great truth of the Christian faith is that whenever I surrender all to Jesus Christ, this is the moment that brings all of God's full and deep and eternal best and blessings into my life. So what does this surrender and blessing look like in somebody's life? Well, to give us a flavour of that, let me take you to a 54-year-old, to Henry. And Henry, he contracted tuberculosis. And he knew that his treatment, that just wasn't working. And he was a Christian, and he was also a songwriter. And so he puts his faith and words onto paper. And he describes for us this all-surrendering faith in the words of a hymn that you may well have sung, "Abide with me." Fast falls the eventide, Henry wrote. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, O abide with me. Life eternal in all of its fullness is God's gift to all who surrender everything to the Lord Jesus. And from Joseph's life in Genesis 40, God this morning, he is going to show us how we do this. And there are three little teaching points that he gives to us to draw out. And so if you've something to note these down on, they will be of help to us as you look at this passage, maybe again later on or in the days that lie ahead. And the first of those little teaching points is this: when all helpers flee, the Lord is present. When all helpers flee, the Lord is present. If you've your Bible open, you will discover this in verse 1 through to verse 4. Now, I don't know about you, but it's a horrible place to feel like there is nobody to help you or to defend you. In other words, to get us out of those hard and hurtful places that we can find ourselves in. Is that not true? Now, Joseph, he had suffered because of the things his brothers and now Potiphar's wife had said and done that just weren't right and fair. He was sold into slavery. He was accused of rape. And in Genesis 39, we find Joseph in lockdown. And now in Genesis 40, it gets even harder as he is summarily thrown into Pharaoh's prison. It will be right and maybe fair to ask the question, what can God be doing, taking Joseph right to the end of himself? He's in a place of no human help where personal resilience and resolve, they just mean nothing. But here God is giving Joseph the greatest of all options, and it's the option of totally surrendering to the Lord. Now, the story of verse 1 to 4 is of Joseph together with the baker and the butler in prison, and they're there for quite some time. And during that time, God shows Joseph he is completely consistent in his goodness. Just like his lockdown in Potiphar's house, again the Lord was with Joseph. And we see evidence of this as he helps Joseph again to adapt, as he elevates him to a place of trust and service. But there is a bigger lesson than these in verse 1 to 4, and it's this. In the classroom of hardship, Joseph's opportunity was to go to a whole new and deeper trust in the Lord. And in the same classroom, this is our option too. One that we can confidently take because the Lord Jesus, he makes a promise to us in 1 Corinthians 10 and 13 where he says, you know, God is faithful and he will not allow you to be tested beyond your power to remain firm. But what does this deep trust, this new trust look like? Well, a couple of days ago, I had a very powerful picture and answer to that question. God answered this in the words of a Christian friend who described their battle in hospital recently with COVID-19. And I was just awed by their example of total surrender to the Lord as they described two nights especially. Whenever they had to battle and that battle was a total surrender of all that they were, of all that they would ever be into the hands of the Lord. In a room in their own, no one else was there except the Lord. And so that is lesson one from this little chapter from Joseph's life. When all helpers flee, the Lord is present. And then the second lesson is that when the Lord is present, don't try to manipulate God. When the Lord is present, don't try to manipulate God. And if you're following along the text, look to verse 5 through to 15. And so here we are, we're back in the cells with Joseph and the baker and the butler. And as Joseph has looked after them, he has got to know them. He's got to know them well enough that one morning he notices this dejected look on the faces of both of them. And he asks what's worrying them, and they answer when they speak of a dream that each one of them has had and of their concern that there is no one there to give a meaning to the dream. And so Joseph's moment has come. His chief gift that God gave him as a teenager, one that he hasn't been able to use now for a number of years, it comes into his own. But note Joseph's words in verse 8, and they're an insightful glimpse to show how Joseph has grown. In those words of verse 8, there's no proud, entitled, self-righteous teenager anymore, because he declares to those two men, he says, interpreting dreams is God's business. And you know, we're kind of cheering Joseph's growth on here. And we're delighted that Joseph's gift is still alive as he tells the butler the meaning. But then there's a but. Look at verse 14 and 15. And here's the but. Joseph tries to manipulate God's plan with his own intervention. As he says to the butler, whenever you tell and see Pharaoh, you tell him all the hurt that I've had. You tell him all the pain that I've had. You tell him that what happened to me at my brother's and in Potiphar's house, it wasn't fair and it wasn't my fault. It all floods out. And the application is this, that total surrender to God's goodness and his plan, it has to be devoid of any tendency to try and manipulate God. Now, for Joseph and for people like me who like to try and fix things, that can be really hard and it requires great patience. And as I think about an example of great patience, my dad actually comes to mind, because in so many challenges in life, that's what he has done. He's patiently surrendered. And as I think back, you know, the Lord, he's never let him down. And so that's lesson two to us from Joseph's life in Genesis 40. When the Lord is present, don't try to manipulate God. And then the third lesson that flows out of this is, whenever the Lord is present, we got to trust that he's good, and we have to trust that he's sovereign. And we find this in verse 16 through to 23. And here we return to the story. And it unfolds that the interpretations that the baker and the butler are given to their dreams, they just happen as Joseph gives them. But I wonder, as the word filters into Joseph's dungeon, I wonder, does hope rise within him about a release? Ah, he might think, yeah, the butlers arrive and I told him to tell Pharaoh, and very soon the jailer's going to come and he's going to let me out. But we need to pause and note here. You know, God could have worked through Joseph's appeal. God could have had Joseph released. But had God done that, Joseph would always have thought, that was me. Look what I did. But instead, God has a bigger and a much more important lesson. Because Joseph needs to know out of conviction, ah, look what the Lord did. And so God gives Joseph some more time, because the extraordinary faith that Joseph is going to need to be prime minister and to save his family and his nation and the surrounding nation, that's going to take an extraordinary preparation. And for Joseph, God is still present and he is still good as we leave Genesis 40. But God gives Joseph some more time to develop this faith of total surrender to God. And with the challenges of life today, isn't such a faith of total surrender so attractive that it doesn't matter what comes along, what changes, what pains, what difficulties come, God is able to work it out. That is a wonderful and attractive, that is such an inviting faith for us to have as a source of our hope and a source of our peace. The good news of the Christian faith is that such a faith, we don't have to earn it. We don't have to work at it. It's a faith that is given as a free gift by Jesus Christ. Through his death for us on the cross, through his resurrection from the empty grave, Jesus has done all the earning of it, so that he can give you and I such a faith of total surrender. But how does he do this? And how do we receive it? Well, this last little story, I think, answers. It was a fierce storm that Augustus' top lady was caught out in Barrington Coombe Gorge in Somerset in England. And as he looked around for shelter, he happened to notice an enormous rock that promised a shelter and a protection. And it did. But that sheltering rock, it inspired him to write the words of a hymn that many of us may have sang, which begins, "Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. But it's in a latter verse of that hymn that describes our how of saying yes to total surrender to Jesus. And these are the words: nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked, come to thee for dress, helpless, look to thee for grace. As we listen to the words now of this hymn, let us worship God, but let us also say yes. Yes, Lord Jesus, I surrender all. And will you give me this faith that gives such peace, that gives such life, that gives such hope?
Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy rib inside which flow be a sin, the double cure. Save me from I'm